Coming up next on The Voice of Alabama Politics, our guest today is Dr. Henry Mabry, Executive Secretary of the Alabama Education Association. Also, the V-Team takes a look at the upside of the 2014 elections. The House Caucus has elected Mike Hubbard, Speaker of the House, once again. Pass the Kool-Aid and the Promise Ring. All this and much, much more coming up next on The V.
The Voice of Alabama Politics with your host, Bill Brett, and the V-Team with Claire Austin, Susan Britt, Jack Campbell, Baron Coleman, Charlana Spencer, and special reports with Jonathan Barbie. Now, the number one political show in Alabama, The V.
Welcome to The Voice of Alabama Politics, where we tackle the tough issues so you have the hard facts. I'm your host, Bill Britt, and as always, I'm joined by the V-Team. Welcome all.
Good morning.
Baron, you have a very impressive beard. Why?
We're celebrating No Shave November.
I'm not participating with the crowd here.
That's right. Everybody else is involved. It's just an opportunity when someone stops and asks you, why do you have a beard, to draw attention to testicular and prostate cancer, two issues that affect uniquely men.
A good reason not to shave and a good cause to make people aware of.
Certainly.
We have a lawsuit that has come out challenging the double-dipping law. This has been put forward by Representative Grimsley, who is a parole officer, a juvenile parole officer. According to the law that went into effect on November 5th, he will no longer be able to hold that job and be a state representative. Baron, what's the hopes of that law being overturned?
Very slim, very, very slim. I mean, I think these have been upheld in other states. It'll be upheld in Alabama. I think the idea is to try to keep people from having a say in the budget on their salary. I mean, I think that's the constitutional basis for it. The reality is you're taking people like, superintendents of schools, teachers of schools, state troopers, others, and you're pulling them out of the pool of people who could potentially be pretty good representatives, both on the Democrat and Republican side. I don't quite know why we have it.
What do you think about that, Claire?
Okay, I guess I've been around this whole issue, but, 10 years ago, this was a big issue, and the Republicans didn't want it, and then they did want it, and everybody was kind of fighting about this back and forth because you had so many people that were presidents of two-year colleges, worked for two-year colleges, teachers in the classroom. Like, for instance, I know Rusty Glover ended up retiring because he was a teacher. I mean, can you imagine being in the state Senate and being a teacher? You cannot be there at least 30 days out of the year. And I just think it's just good business, I think. And I just think they fought so hard about it. I just see a very slim chance of something like
this. Don't see this happening, do you, Jack?
No, I don't. And it, like Alan Treadaway, there's not a better public servant than Alan Treadaway. And he's a police officer in Birmingham, downtown Birmingham. He's a great guy, but he makes it work. I mean, he puts in his hours and has enough leave time that he can come down here and do this. If you can work it out, I don't see what the problem is.
Well, it's tough. I mean, I know Senator Glover did, but it was very difficult, particularly when you have a three-hour drive versus an hour and a half. It's tough.
Well, and I think they meant this law to last. I think it's going to stand. Nothing's going to happen with it. Very interesting. You guys had former Representative Artur Davis on your radio show this week. Very great guest. He's looking at running for mayor of Montgomery. As a lifelong Montgomeryan, what do you think about that?
Well, he got quizzed on the show about, well, you've lived in D.C. and then you went to Virginia, but he grew up here. He's got roots in Montgomery. His mom still lives here. I went to Jeff Davis and Montgomery Academy. He has, to me, very good credentials. I think he will be a very qualified candidate to run in what could be a crowded field this year, depending upon whether Todd Strange runs again.
He spoke at the Republican convention. He was very impressive when he spoke. He switched from a Democrat to being a Republican. But many people, Claire, have always said he's been a very conservative Democrat in the past.
He has. I've known Archer for a long time and even, have been friends with him and worked for him. when he ran the first time for Congress, and he represented this district of Alabama very well. But like everybody, I think, you know, not being here in the trenches is going to be a negative for him. Would he be a breath of fresh air? Would he do a great job? I think absolutely. But I think the field is going to be crowded because the rumors are pretty stout that Strange won't run.
Well, Joe Hubbard has said he may throw his hat in. Barron, what's your take on that?
Joe Hubbard has talked about getting in, or at least people have talked about Joe Hubbard getting in. Mm-hmm. Quentin Ross, potentially. Elton Dean, chairman of the county commissioner. Quentin Ross, state senator from Montgomery. There is going to be a crowded field. There are going to be several people. The question for Artur Davis is going to be, are there going to be enough voters that hold it against him that he hadn't lived here in the last few years, that he's been up in Birmingham, that he's been up in Virginia, and now he's just making his way back to Montgomery? If somebody says, look, that's a deal breaker, there's nothing he's going to be able to say to win that guy back.
And there is some heartburn in the African-American community that he switched parties from Democrat to Republican, and that's not very popular among African-Americans.
Yeah, and I think that's probably what's going to hurt him in a municipal election here.
You think that, I mean, am I right in assuming that the African-American vote will make the difference in this election?
Yeah, they don't turn out as much in municipal elections because they're in August. It's kind of an odd time. The white vote typically turns out a little higher. Their vote typically is better represented in the municipal elections. But to suggest that you can win it without considering the African-American vote in Montgomery would be foolish.
Yeah, and I think you probably, if you have 4 or 5, you're going to have a runoff. And I think that Artur will pull from the white population as well.
I do, too.
Well, I think he's wise to come back to Alabama and see what he can do. I'm all for spirited competition.
We've got about eight months more of that. We have plenty of time.
Well, it gives us something to talk about. One of the statements that have been made after the 2014 general election is that the Democratic Party in Alabama is irrelevant. Representative Dario Melton said that they're not irrelevant, they just didn't show up at the polls. Jack, are they irrelevant or did they not show up at the polls?
Both.
Both. Okay.
They're becoming more irrelevant every day, and they didn't vote. I mean, we had 41% turnout. That's pitiful. But they did it to themselves. The legislators drew the districts. And if you didn't win the primary, the real race was the primary, not the general. So they did it to themselves.
We got about 45 seconds. Is there any way, Barron, for the Democratic Party to come back in the near future?
Not in the next 30 years. Not in Alabama, not in the next 30 years. Because nationally, they're too far outside of the mainstream of Alabama thought. Alabamians are not a liberal people, period.
We're going to have to hold it right there. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Our guest is Dr. Henry Mabry, Executive Secretary of the Alabama Education Association.
Well, you may run
we'll be right back.
On for a long time. Run on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Let me tell you.
The V is sponsored by Spot On Strategies Group.
Will cut you down.
Welcome to Alabama's newest entertainment destination, Wind Creek Wetumpka. The perfect escape for date night, a getaway with your friends, or a relaxing poolside cocktail. Whether it's a day trip to enjoy the best steak in Alabama or a romantic weekend, the finest southern hospitality is just a short drive away. Wind Creek Wetumpka. Find your winning moment.
Welcome back to the Voice of Alabama Politics. Our guest today is Dr. Henry Mabry from the Alabama Education Association. Welcome, Dr. Mabry.
Mr. Britt, good to be here. Thank you.
Your organization represents about 90,000 individuals in the state of Alabama who serve our children. They have about as close a relationship as our kids as any people outside their own parents. You represent those people. Who are they? Who are they?
These people that are members of the Alabama Education Association are the teachers, the bus drivers, the cafeteria workers, the school nurses, administrators, professors in two-year colleges. These are the people that interface with our school children every single day of the school year.
Why do they need to have an organization to represent them in Alabama? What's the purpose of the AEA?
The purpose of the Alabama Education Association, and this has been the case since it was founded in 1859, is to promote what is best for our schools. For decade after decade after decade, we've had legislatures that control the schools, control the money, control how the schools operate, control how both the students and the personnel are treated. Many times you have politicians that don't appreciate public education and don't want to support public education. That's why AEA exists. That's why AEA has existed over the decades, because without having someone there to rally the cry when people don't do what they need to do for the benefit of these school children, we've got to be there.
The Education Trust Fund is one of the more sacred deposits of money that we have. And yet we have seen year after year, whether Republican or Democrat, that pot of money is where they go for it. And you help protect that, don't you?
Well, that is our job. We've got to protect education's money. And the Education Trust Fund goes for the benefit of the public schools, the two-year colleges, and the universities. Without those protections, that money is going to be siphoned off and go to Medicaid or for the prisons. That's why the Education Trust Fund was created in the first place.
Just last year, the state legislature passed, they tried to raid the Education Trust Fund on behalf of the prisoners of Alabama. And the teachers and the workers in public education were outraged, but they only have one voice, really, and they need the AEA to make that heard.
We don't apologize for that. We have got, there are so many, there are limited dollars for public education, just like there are limited dollars to run general government in the state. But what is clear is the people want money that's dedicated to going to the public schools, going to the public schools, and not to help the prisons. What we're trying to do with public education is avoid having future children become prisoners. And the way for that to happen is to ensure that they have a good, good, solid background, a good, solid education.
Your membership, like the state of Alabama, is diverse. You have what we hear, you know, basically some 60% are Republicans, some 40% are Democrats, or some mix thereof. But you all seem to agree on the fact that this Alabama Accountability Act that was passed under the cloak of darkness by the Republican supermajority has been bad for education, whether it's Republican or Democrat. If you're an educator, you see that as bad. Why is this Accountability Act a bad thing?
This Accountability Act was passed, as you said, it was under the cloak of darkness. In the 11th hour, it was a switcheroo on the bills. It replaced a motherhood and apple pie bill that was called the flexibility bill to help cut down red tape in the school systems. And then when it was substituted with the Accountability Act, it was a totally different animal. The Accountability Act calls for giving public school money for the support of our public school children to private schools. We have limited resources in Alabama. We've had the largest funding cuts for public education in Alabama compared to any other state in the country since the beginning of the 2008 recession. So if we already don't have needed funds to run our schools, if we don't have the money to provide textbooks so our children have textbooks to take home to study. Right now, we have a third of our school children that don't have textbooks to take home to study. I don't know about you, but when I was a child, I needed textbooks to take home and study.
Absolutely.
If we don't have money to provide textbooks for all our students, we sure certainly don't have money to give tens of millions of dollars to the benefit of private schools.
Governor Bentley eventually came around to thinking that this Accountability Act, where it basically takes $1,000 out of every classroom in the state, not a good idea. But it's been pushed through by Senator Dale Marsh. Senator Dale Marsh has been the biggest advocate for that, along with Mike Hubbard and Bob Riley. But I want to talk about Senator Marsh, because recently after the general elections, he said he would no longer work with the AEA. How do you have the president pro tem of the Alabama Senate say he will not work with a group that represents 90,000 Alabamians?
Well, you made one point in your intro to this topic. You said that he will no longer work with AEA. My question is, when has he ever worked with AEA? That doesn't bother me, because the last time we actually tried to work with Senator Marsh is when he pulled the stunt with the Alabama Accountability Act. We were under the impression that we were going to get something worked out on the flexibility bill, and then lo and behold, he switches the two bills under the cloak of darkness, surprising everybody, where he admitted that he had to trick everyone to get that bill passed. So that's the last time that he, quote, tried to work with us. If that is, that's the case where he's going to try to work with us, then there's no, there's really no point.
I don't want to give myself any vain glory, but if there's two people whose heads are wanted in the state of Alabama, it's yours and mine, and yours more than mine. Of course, you have a bigger head and a bigger brain than I do, and I appreciate that, because I'm not as smart as you are. But why do you, this election, you worked hard to elect Democrats and Republicans that would represent the best interest of educators. You won some and you lost some. Why are you being criticized so severely?
Well, it's a point of, if we had won every single one of our races, the opposition would find fault with what we did. That's just the way it is. That's how it works in Montgomery. You know, right now they say, we lost all these elections, it was a disaster, what have you. But they don't want to talk about what happened in June when we won those races. In the last year, we have beaten 10 anti-education Republican candidates for the State House of Representatives. Yes, we didn't do well in the State Senate. We just didn't. But we did do well on the House side, where we beat 10 anti-education Republicans and replaced them with Republicans who will be more favorable to public education. I think we don't hear much about that. Why don't we hear much about that? Because the other side, of course, doesn't want to give us any credit. But if you look at what happened during the last the runoff election up in Coleman, with when we were trying to get rid of anti-education Republican Representative Mac Buttram,
right.
There were 30 or 40 House members, Republican House members, most of whom, I could say all of whom were anti-education, up there trying to get him elected because he was, quote, their cloture vote. So I don't have any regrets other than President Obama being president right now, because he was the one that they ran against. They don't have any mandate whatsoever other than to say that Alabama is going to be against anything that President Obama puts before the Alabama legislature.
I didn't see Obama on the ticket, but he was certainly there, wasn't he?
He absolutely was on the ticket in that they used him as a diversion, red meat for Alabama voters. They say that it wasn't about race, but it was absolutely about race. They threw him out there. They spent millions upon millions of dollars. They didn't talk about Alabama issues. They talked about President Obama and worked to link him to candidates, both Republican and Democrat.
Right.
They did it. Our opposition did it in the June primaries. They did it in November.
I want to switch over. Just take about 30 seconds here. I know you. I know your family. You know mine. You have school-age children, ages 12 to about 16 months. On a personal level, how important is education for your children?
Education for children. And I just go back to my grandfather. He used to always say, don't count on anything other than your education. Concentrate on school, and you'll be fine in life. And I'd say that for my children. I look at them, and I see these small minds getting developed and what they learn in school. It's just amazing to me what they are able to learn at such a young age, because it seems like when we were children, we didn't learn some of these things till later on. But we've got to be competitive, and my children have got to be competitive growing up. And if they don't get a solid education, then they're not going to be all they can be. And, you know, the Lord wants us all to use our abilities to the best of our ability. And if we don't do that, then we're not doing what we should do.
Well, I want to thank you for joining us today and sharing your heart, sharing your passion with us. Thank you for your service to the state. Our guest has been Dr. Henry Mabry. We'll be right back with the V-Team.
The V is sponsored by MediaWorks Communications, quality video production and marketing services. The Locker Room, fine men's clothing.
Welcome back to the V, the voice of Alabama politics. Just days after the elections, the Republican House caucus met in secret and reelected by a unanimous margin Speaker Mike Hubbard back to his office. This is a man who is charged by the state of Alabama with 23 felony conviction of public corruption. Jack, explain it to me.
I don't understand it. It's insane. There's got to be economic ties between
egregious,
those who
egregious. And it was done by
Republican
Attorney General.
If I'm a CEO of a corporation and my executive vice president has 23 indictment counts, I'm going to ask him to step down either with or without pay until it's resolved. Right. These people are putting a guy on a throne that they don't know what his political future is. It's dangerous for the party, and it's dangerous for the state.
But as a lifelong Republican, how do you do that, Claire?
Well, for the record, you say they reelected, and this was they couldn't.
It's a caucus vote.
Yeah, it's a caucus vote, and they really can't legally do that until January. It's kind of like a promissory note. Like, I love you, and I'll tell you I'm going to really love you in January, okay?
So they slipped a promise ring on us.
Yeah, they've slipped a promise ring, yeah. And I have a feeling there's going to be a lot of people change their minds between now and January. But, I mean, I agree. I don't know. It's dumbfounding, I think, to a lot of people, given exactly what Jack said. And you know what? I didn't see his name in this book.
No, probably won't. You're in his book, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Barron, really, what's your take on this? I mean, this is serious business here.
It is serious business. It goes back to something you raised in the first segment. Are the Democrats relevant? And the answer is no, because if they were, there would have been enough Democrats that a few Republicans could have teamed together, and the headline wouldn't be Hubbard reelected as Speaker. Right. The headline would be caucus votes in favor of Hubbard. Let's wait and see how the Democrats weigh in down the road.
Right, right.
And that's the problem, is there's so few Democrats, they have so little influence. I think a lot of the Republicans just threw up their hands and said, look, we maybe had the Democrats picked up a few seats or held even, we could have gotten 15 or 20 of us together. But now that they've actually lost seats, we're never going to get 25 or 30 of us to overrule Mike.
Jack, one of the things I heard is that there was a coalition that was standing together, and then when Barry Moore was found not guilty of lying to a grand jury, that coalition faded away.
I'm not sure it put a chink in the armor of the other faction who clearly is not in favor of Mike Hubbard. I don't think it's dead yet. I think what Claire said is true. Their vote is not, even though by caucus rules it's right. binding, it's not legally binding. So
right.
in January when we have the organizational session, I don't think you're going to see that overwhelming support.
Well, I'll say this. By losing the case, the prosecutors lost what I think is a lot of the PR cover
right.
that was going on around them.
Right.
there was an aura of invincibility around Matt Hart and Van Davis that, boy, once they had their man in sight, they could take their man down under any circumstances. They walked in a relatively simple trial that everybody, I mean, if you read some of the media accounts, a lot of the media was making fun of the defense team for even bothering to put up a challenge, saying, what on earth are they even trying this case for? And then they walk in and lose it. And I think a lot of the people that were around providing sort of this political cover for the prosecution team became dumbfounded and are now floundering around in the dark. And Mike Hubbard has used that to his advantage. He went to the members of the House of Representatives, the Republicans, and said, look, you can oppose me now, and I'll make your life hell for the next 2 months until we get to the organizational session, is I think how it happened, because there's still a lot of money to raise between now and March.
Well, and I know that what you're saying. I mean, as a person who has written over 150,000 words on Mike Hubbard, we figured them up the other day, I was shocked that his indictment had as little effect politically as it did.
But if you look at all the people who stood with him, all the people who we think voted for him, they got a ton of money, either in kind or direct contributions, from Storm PAC, which is Mike Hubbard's political action committee, and PAC 2014 PAC, which is run by Bob Riley. If you were to, and we're doing the research on it, you're going to find, I'll guarantee you, a money trail.
Well, and I think you're right on
that. Yeah, and back to that, step back about 4 years ago prior to that, y'all. Majority of these people that have voted for him like that were never elected to office until 4 years ago. They don't know what it is really like being in the legislative process with a two-party system. And there are many other Republicans that have been there a long time that they just know life under Mike Hubbard and the dictatorship, and they're scared.
Well, I got to change the subject right here to something that's near and dear to my heart. We only got about 1 minute. Senator Arthur Orr, along with Senator Phil Williams and the supermajority in the Senate, plans on limiting who can cover the press at the State House, and their target, number one, is the Alabama political reporter. How do you feel, Barron, about freedom of the press being decided by the Senate of Alabama?
I think it needs to be a neutral person that's not a political appointee, somebody that needs to be the person issuing press credentials. The representatives who are being covered should have no say in it.
I think from my standpoint, you know, we go back to the founding of this country. Freedom of the press is enshrined in our Constitution. And what they meant was the lone pamphleteer that had a right to speak out against the crown and the government. I think that's where we are today. We're going to have to leave it right there. You've been watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. You can catch us every Sunday on your ABC affiliates throughout the state. Thank you for watching.